صلى الله وسلم عليك يا رسول الله وعلى أهل بيتك المعصومين المنتجبين. يا ليتنا كنا معكم سادتي فنفوز فوزا عظيما. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. قد أفلح من زكاها وقد خاب من دساها. آمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوات اللهم صل على محمد. Once again we thank Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for granting us with another wonderful opportunity, wonderful moment. Tonight being the night of the 17th of the holy month of Ramadan, we ask Almighty Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to accept our humble efforts in this holy month and make it easy and possible for each and every one of us to witness the last days and the last night of this holy month of Ramadan, inshallah. If brothers and sisters will recall very well, last night we dwell on a discussion on the importance of paying attention to our soul and nafs. And we gave an example between the soul, the intellect, and the body. And we said what is most important to us is to look after our soul. And if you remember very well, I went down to give a lot of examples on how the soul function and how the intellect function and how the body function. We got to a point where I was explaining that the one who has the authoritative power is the soul, is the nafs, and not the intellect. Although we have riwayat from Ahlul Bayt salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhim, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, regarding the importance of soul, of intellect, that huwa ma ubida bihi ar-rahman wa iktusiba bihi al-jinan. Intellect is what Allah is worshipped with, and it is what one aims and obtains Jannah with. But if you remember very well, last night we said, when you look at your intellect, and you look at your soul, and you look at your body, each and every one of these three things is in need of provisions and food. And we said the food for our intellect is these informations that we have. Today, the world is not short of informations. The world is not short of knowledge. We are full of informations. We are full of knowledge. The same thing, our body, as I mentioned, this is a recap, then we continue. Our body also needs its food. And the food you all have, you have the best of cars, you have the best of clothes, you have the best of houses, you have the best of lotions, you name them. But what is ignored in our lives today and our communities is our soul. The soul is often neglected. The soul is not taken care of. I gave an example last night. Today, when you go to the western part of the world, you may find people, wallahi, when they start opening their mouth, I'm not talking even of Muslims, non-Muslims, their knowledge, you will melt in front of them. When they open their mouth speaking even about Islam, you will melt completely. What is only shortage is that nafs, soul is not taken care of. Therefore, Amir al-Mu'mineen, salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi, gave us a description of soul or nafs and the description of our intellect. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen said, this nafs that you see, if you do not look after it, it becomes an enemy to your intellect. And as I mentioned, if you remember, We said the nafs is the center of emotions and the center of desires and passions. So therefore, Mawlai Kainat is saying, if the nafs is not given the right food, then that nafs will become an enemy to your intellect. Therefore, one riwayah also said, kadakharakati shahawat akla, yani the desires and the passions and the lust that we have bent and destroyed our intellect completely. Today, upon all the knowledges that we have, upon all the informations that we have, we are still not finding it very, very difficult to get closer to Allah. We have all the information. We're not short of information. But it is very difficult for me and you, as I mentioned, to become a neighbor to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, Quran came forward and comments on the role of our nafs. And Quran said, the success of every individual is dependent on the amount of attention he or she gives to his or her soul. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala said, وَأَمَّا مَنْ خَافَ مَقَامَ رَبِّهِ وَنَهَى النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَى فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَهْوَى. Allah is talking about the nafs, that whoever is having the consciousness of Allah, and then he or she makes sure that he overcome he or herself desire and interest. فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَوَى. Indeed, Jannah will be your abode. Therefore, Rasulullah came forward and said, مَنْ لَمْ يُحَذِّبْ نَفْسَهُ لَمْ يَنْتَفِعْ بِأَكْلِهِ. Whoever fails to look after the soul, he or she will not benefit from the intellect. Irrespective of the amount of information that you have. Tonight, I want us to look at some of the diseases of our souls and nafs and how to overcome them. And remember, I mentioned our aim is for our fast in the month of Ramadan to become ibadah malakuti and not ibadah mulki. We have ibadah mulki where you show your strength, you are healthy, you can fast, you can eat the best of food for iftar, you can wear the best of the clothes on the day of Eid, you've got the best of the car to drive you to the mosque. That is show of strength. That is not the ibadah we want to achieve by the end of Ramadan. We want to achieve ibadah malakuti. That is ibadah which comes with khushu and humility. That is the Ramadan me and you want. Well, life of the Ramadan is just come, iftar, sit, laugh, and go, then it's a waste of time. We want a ibadah malakuti. What is ibadah malakuti? Whereby after Ramadan, I become the same person. After Ramadan, that love of Allah, that josh which I developed in the month of Ramadan, it continues with me until. Therefore, the ibadah we want is malakuti. Today, wallahi, I tell you, our prayers and ibadah is mulki. It's not malakuti. We have not yet reached that malakuti. It's just mulki. Mulki means we are just doing because the caravan is going. We are also following the caravan. Therefore, Allah said your success is dependent on how you look after this soul and how you select and choose the best food for this soul. Once you give this soul the best food it requires, then rest assured you will be the best person in the eye of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To such an extent, Quran is telling us, whoever fails to look after his or her soul, he is of no benefit. Allah said, سَأَسْرِفْ عَنْ آيَاتِنَا الَّذِينَ يَتَكَبَّرُونَ. Remember we said one of the major disease of the heart is kibr, takabbur. Takabbur, arrogance, is one of the major disease of the heart. And when we look at takabbur, the opposite of takabbur is tawadu, humility. But now humility comes as a result of sincerity and khulus. Today, most of our works are void of ikhlas. When there is no ikhlas, there will be takabbur. And when there is takabbur, the nafs will overpower a person. And the intellect will be as if it does not exist. Now, this takabbur, or this ikhlas, you go back to your nafs. Everybody, I want to go back to your nafs now. Ask yourself, If people stop to praise me for the good things that I've been doing, will I be the same person or I will change? You ask yourself that question. Whatever chidma you give to people, it could be money you're giving them charity. It could be orphanage you built. It could be mosque that you are helping. Whatever you do, be it small or big, you ask yourself, ask your nafs. If people stop to praise me the way they are praising me for what I'm doing, will I continue to do it or I will stop from doing it? Now, one scholar in Hausa, in Qom, one day was sitting with his students. Any students sitting in the mosque. And he was giving them Bahth al-Kharij. So he asked them, I want to ask you a question and ask myself this question. If today or tomorrow, all of you leave here and go to another scholar who is of the same caliber like me, of the same strength like me, of the same knowledge like me, and only four of you remain here with me, what will be my situation? Then he taught them, this is where my ikhlas will be judged. Will I be happy or I will be sad because they've gone to somebody else? He said, if I become sad, then I am not mukhlis. If I become happy, then I am mukhlis. Because at the end of the day, I am doing it for Allah. I'm not doing it for anyone else. Therefore, Allama Murtada Mutahhari, in one of his teachings, very beautiful saying about ikhlas, that if it's not in one's life, can lead a person to become mutakabbir. Mutahhari said, all of us, we love Islam, but on condition that each and every one of us is called the Hujjat al-Islam al-Muslimin. He said, wallah, if we are not called Hujjat al-Islam and other person is called Hujjat al-Islam, we will not love Islam. So therefore, this all goes to sincerity. And what Allah wants is that sincerity from you. Therefore, Imam al-Khumayni rahmatullah alayh also said, if all prophets and messengers will be brought together at one place, they will not have one misunderstanding between themselves. Then Imam explained, why wouldn't they have misunderstanding? Then Imam said, because they will never say ana, ana, ana. Whatever they do, they will say he, he. He means Allah. Ana, 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 ana means me. You know, today, why I fight with you is because of ana and you. If that ana, 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 ana is removed from us, nobody will fight anyone, even in the community, I promise you. Why this one fighting the other is because he's thinking his opinion is the best opinion, and I'm thinking my opinion is the best opinion. Therefore, Imam is saying, if you bring all prophets together, they will never fight because the question is about Allah. It's not about me or you. And whatever you do it for the sake of Allah. This is where Mawlai Kainat came forward and described really the arrogance and the takabbur of shaitan and what brought shaitan down completely. He gave a very beautiful example in one of his teachings. He said, shaitan made the sajda for the sake of Allah for a period of 6,000 years. Sajda. Because you know this Iblis, we believe was an angel. Because angels are those liars, it was like a jinn. Because angels lie asun Allah ma wa faluna ma yumarun. So this jinn is like us. We've got the desire, we've got the intellect, we've got the imagination. So Imam Amir al-Mumini said, he made sajida, two sajida only for 6,000 years. And Imam said, we don't even know those 6,000, is it the counting of this dunya or the counting of Allah? Because the counting of Allah, wa inna yawman in the rabbika ka alfi sanatin mimma ta'uddun. One day in the eye of Allah is like alf sana, 1,000 years of your counting of this world. Imam said, we don't know. But Imam Amir al-Mumin said, yes, let's assume it's the counting of this world. Only 1 second and one moment took shaitan backward, as if shaitan never existed. The same thing applies to me and you. Takabbur is something that takes us far away from Allah. And that removes that love for Allah from our hearts. And that deny and deprive us of the taste of every worship that we do. Therefore, number one, brothers, everybody try. You know, one way or the other, all of us, we have here and there some sense of takabbur in us. Everybody should try to work
over this takabbur. Try to overcome this kibur. Try to stay away from it. Because once you have takabbur, it brings you down. You will be nothing in the eye of Allah, even if you are somebody in the eye of people. Ikhlas is what Allah wants. Therefore, scholars came forward. What is important to Allah is not kamiya, it's kaifiya. Quantity is not important to Allah. What is important to Allah is the quality. What you give to Allah, if it is small, with sincerity, it takes you from depth to depth to the highest level in the eye of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now you see, let us look at the impact of takabbur in our lives. And then we look at the solution which are regarded as the food for our souls. Number one negative impact of the disease of our hearts, it darkens the soul and the heart. It makes it dark completely. You don't see anything anymore. You tell them about Allah, it goes here, it goes out of there. It makes the heart and the soul dark completely. Number two, al-istidraj, one repeatedly indulging into sin. Because now the sin has darkened the heart, so he keeps on indulging into the same sin. He keeps on indulging and indulging and indulging. Number three, riwaya taught us, when you engrossed and overwhelmed in becoming mutakabbir, everything you want to be told is you. Everything you want to be labeled is you. Everything, if you were not there, it will not happen. If we were not there, it was not going to happen. If I wasn't there, if it wasn't because of my opinion, it will not. Who are you? This takabbur, they said, once you keep on having it in your life, it creates certain fire in your heart. And what is the role of that fire? Whenever good things come to it, it chases it away. Therefore, when you are called for a'amal, you stay away. When you are called for ibadah, you stay away. When you are called for good things in Islam, you stay away. But when you are invited for something that constitutes nothing in your love for Allah, you rush and go. You have to pause a little bit and look at yourself. Pause a little bit, wallah. And I said, we are not out of it. We are also affected. It's all because of the small sins that we are. Somebody came to Amir al-Mu'mineen and asked Amir al-Mu'mineen, why now and then I would attend your majlis? You would say something amazing. But when I go back and go out, I would practice something else. Imam said, check your heart and check your stomach. Maybe what is entering your stomach, it is a mixture of illicit and licit something. And then Imam at the end told him also, maybe anta abidu dunya or abdu dunya, you are a servant of this world. So therefore, the third negative impact of takabbur and gurur in our lives is that it creates that fire. Once that fire is created, every good thing that come, it blocks it. You don't see it anymore. Therefore, you see sometimes when you stand to perform salat, wallah, you ask your nafs, I want to really to judge yourself, brothers. How do you feel when you stand to perform salat? You be sincere to yourself. When you go home, you ask yourself, do you feel happy sometimes? Don't you think sometimes you feel yani heavy, yani this salat must just finish, let him go? That is disease of the soul. That is disease of the heart, wallahi. Therefore, scholars said there are people, when it's time for ibadah, they found it thakil, heavy on their shoulder. He said, that is a sign of having a sickness in your heart. So therefore, this thing will create that. It will take you far away. And as a result of that, laziness overwhelms you. Today you look at Ramadan. In Ramadan, today Muslim communities, there are very, very wrong cultures that we inculcate in Ramadan. When Allah has provided this month for you to nurture and nurse your soul, the amount of time we spend on things that have nothing to do with our soul in Ramadan are more than the amount of time we spend for the food of our soul. I'll give you an example. Yes, Ramadan, you need to enjoy yourself sometimes also, as I'll mention later. Amir al-Mu'mineen said, you divide it four times your time in life. One for ibadah, one to be with your family, one to gain halal rizq, and want to be with your friends to spend a very lawful entertainment. But you look at Ramadan. Sometimes when we say there is going to be club is good, no problem. I don't have a problem with club. But sometimes the amount of time you spend there, when you are invited for ibadah, how do you respond to ibadah? And Ramadan is getting out of our hand. It's going. Today is 16, it's going. Have we benefited? Yet our soul is crying every day. Isn't it Mawlai Kainat said, you are looking for success. And that success in yourself, you have lost yourself completely and you don't know how to look for it. So therefore, let's all calm down and pause and start thinking. 14 days remain. What must I do to beef up myself and to give my soul the food it requires before it is too late? Therefore, these are some of the negative impacts of the sins of takabbur and gurur that we have in our life. But what are the solutions? This is my main important point of tonight. There are problems, then there must be solutions to these problems. Solution number one is to have a quwwatul irada, willpower. Whoever has no willpower will not succeed spiritually. You need willpower. When you are around your friends and you engross in speaking in that night of Ramadan, there should be a moment when your willpower will tell you, guys, let us call it a night. Let us call it a day. It is time for me to go and communicate to my Lord. You need willpower. How do you develop willpower? Through three steps. Very practical steps I want to give you. How do you develop willpower? You need to have a willpower to be successful. If you do not have willpower, I promise you will not be successful. Number one, there are three senses in our lives that are regarded as the most powerful senses. You need to be careful how you use them. One of them is this mouth. And the other one is this eye. And the other one is this ears. These are the three powerful senses that we have. Wallahi, if you do not look after these three powerful senses, you will be led astray by either community or environment or individuals. And out of all these three, the most powerful one is the ears. Therefore, Mawlai Kainat said, our ears are doors to our heart. Know what you listen to and know what you take. Know what you see and know what you accept. Know what comes out of your mouth and what enters into your mouth. Therefore, look after these three senses. They are major senses in our lives. They constitute our success in our life. Today, all the downfall of whoever is down is out of these three things. Now, number two, let all part of your body be used to ibadah. It needs training. It does not happen overnight. You have to train that part of the body. Once you train it properly, then it responds to ibadah. If your body is used to ibadah, it will never be lazy to respond to the calling of Allah. If your body is used to a'mal, it will never be lazy to respond to the calling to a'mal. And the same thing, if your body is used to something else, not ibadah, you will not hesitate to respond to it. They say, let your body get used to this ibadah. Now and then go for ibadah. Yes, of course, Islam taught us also, لِلْقُلُوبِ إِدْبَارٌ وَإِكْبَالٌ. Our souls and hearts are of two moods, good mood and bad mood. Said, whenever you are in good mood, do more of a ibadah to train your soul and your body. Do the wajib and add on top of the wajib the mustahabbat, add more. But they said, whenever you see yourself in a bad mood, Do only the wajibat and relax. Or else if you push it, you will crush the soul. It's very, very important. But we sometimes, even in a good mood, we don't use it. When we are in a good mood, we rather talk and talk and talk and talk. Even in Ramadan. You cannot talk when you are in a good mood. This is a riwayah from Imam Jafar alayhi salatu wasalam. That good mood, bad mood. Bad mood, leave it. Wajib, finish, done. Quran, you don't want to recite, leave it, it's not wajib. Tahajjud, you don't want to do, leave it, it's not wajib. But when you are in good mood, you are excited, stand there and perform every namaz you can perform. So number two is that let the system get used to ibadah. Train it. Number two and number three, which is very, very important, all of us have a role to play. They call it at-taqaleed wal-a'raf. Custom. Culture. They said whoever find him or herself in a community whose aim is spiritual and Allah, that person will also fall in. So therefore here we all have a role to play in the community. Our community must be the community of God loving people. The community of those who love Allah. The community of those who are aspiring to seek nearness to Allah. These are the people who can influence you. Therefore, Riwayah said, when you are in the midst of people who fail to remind you of Allah, stay away from them. Even such an extent, Imam alayhi salatu wasalam, our Sif Imam mentioned, the best guide is the one whom when you look at his or her face, he or she remind you of the day of Qiyamah. So therefore, your friend, your alim, your guide must be someone who remind you of Allah and remind you of the day of Qiyamah, because community and friends also have a role to play. We have a role to play. If community, there is increment of Allah, 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 then it will affect each and every individual in the community. But if there is no Allah, Allah, what is being mentioned, it will also affect people. Therefore, very, very important, the third point is that all must play a role in the community to be the community full of divinity and love for Allah, especially in the month of Ramadan. The last but not least point, which is very, very important, which we all know, is muhasaba. But this muhasaba, self-judgment, scholars divide it into two. One part of muhasaba is to have individual spiritual program. What time I go to club? What time I leave club? What time I go for sahari gathering? What time I leave there? عليكم بتقوى الله ونظم أمركم أمير المؤمنين. Have a taqwa consciousness and be organized. They said order and taqwa are complementing one another. Wherever you see order in the spiritual life of a person, you should know that behind it is taqwa. And wherever you see taqwa, you should know that the immediate consequence of that taqwa will be for one to organize him or herself on how to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So muhasibah, we talk of muhasibah, it's a very long discussion. Muhasibah, one aspect of it, organize yourself. Nobody will organize you, you have to organize your spiritual life. The way you organize your material life, you know the time you wake up for work. You look at yourself. Even if you sleep 4:30, the next day you'll go to work on time. But sometimes we miss Salat Fajr in Ramadan. This is something, wallahi, to cry sometimes. How can I miss Fajr in Ramadan? How? When this is the month of Ibadah. How? It doesn't make sense. It means we are risking our souls. We are risking our lives. It means we have not understood the essence of Ramadan completely. So therefore, that muhasiba, organize yourself. Sit properly. Write it. 14 days is a lot of days. 2 weeks is more. Organize yourself. When you sleep, when you wake up, you must. And the last but not least aspect of muhasiba, scholars taught us, is that one should feel pain when he has done wrong. You should feel pain when you are lazy to perform your salah. You should feel pain and cry within yourself. Therefore, Ahlul Bayt taught us, we have two eyes. Everything of your body are two. These eyes, there is one, this one, and there is one inside. This one, they call it basar. And that inside, they call it basira. Eyesight, insight. What is important to Allah is that insight, not this eyesight. This is nothing. This insight, the basira. So if you fail to adhere to the teachings of Allah, the insight should tell you. There should be tears within yourself, not necessarily tears coming here. So therefore, the second aspect of muhasaba is I cry. There are those when they miss salat, they are okay. It's part of their lives, but not Ramadan. In conclusion, Ramadan is a platform for all that I've mentioned. Just a summary I gave you. There are some important food that Allah made them available and ready for us in this month of Ramadan to use it properly to feed our nafs and soul. One of them is seclusion. Ma'rifatun nafs. For one to know himself. And Allah provided us ingredients of knowing ourselves. Number one, munajat. Munajat in this month. What is munajat? You have to talk to your Lord alone. Talk to him. Open your heart. Nobody is there sitting next to you. Talk to Allah. Allah, this is my problem. Abu Abdullah taught us in Dua Arafah, Analazi akhta'atu, Analazi jahiltu, Analazi akhta'atu. I am the one who did ignorance. I am the one who made mistake. I am the one who committed wrong. Abu Abdullah, Masoom. So number one, Munajat. We have Munajat of Amir al-Mu'minina. You can also sit alone and talk to Allah. Really, when last did we all sit individually and talk to Allah? Talk to him in Gujarati. Talk to him in Urdu if you can. Talk to him in Swahili. Talk to him in your own language. Express your feeling down deep your heart. Talk to Allah. Ramadan is a platform to talk to Allah. When Mawlai Kainat in that mihrab of Mosque of Kufa said, Mawlaya ya Mawla, Antal Mawla wa ana al-abd, wa aliya raham al-abda illa al-Mawla. Imam is trying to tell us, let us have seclusion sometimes. Sit alone, talk to Allah. Because once you are able to know yourself, it's easy to get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But if you don't do munajat, it becomes a problem. Isn't it? We are told in the riwaya, one day Mawlai Kainat was passing by the Kufa market and he stood there. Then he cried. Tears overflew from the eyes of Amir al-Mu'mineen. People asked him, why are you crying? Imam said, it's because these people, they wake up early morning and they come to their businesses. And they knock off so late. By the time they get back home, they are so tired. When do they have time to discover themselves? So therefore, Ramadan provides us with that opportunity, which cannot be found in any other month, in any other day. Therefore, munajat, have time for that. The second thing, which also is one of the verification of munajat, is Salatul Layl, which is topic on its own. I don't perform Salatul Layl. Fine. At least Ramadan. At least. Allah said, Inna nashi'ata al-layl hiya ashaddu wat'an wa aqwa muqila. Very amazing ayah. That this night vigil, it gives life to your soul. It's one aspect where I communicate to Allah. I talk to Allah alone. I'm trying to discover myself. I'm trying to know who I am. Another platform that Ramadan provides is dua. How many du'as we have in Ramadan? And we are told two major philosophies du'a has. The first philosophy of du'a is idhabat al-gurur. Du'a helps you to overcome arrogance and pride. Because you see, in al-insana layatga ar-ra'ahu stagna. Man exceeds limits. He raises shoulders when he realizes that he's got authority, thinking that he's better than everyone. Once you sit in du'a, with that authority you claim to have, dua will bring you down. Because you know you are sitting in front of someone who says, Antumul fuqara'u ilallah. Wallahu huwa al-ganiyul hamid. Dua, Ramadan, provide platform. I ask you a question. Who has missed dua iftitah since Ramadan? Days you cannot afford to miss, ya Allah. Platform, dua is taking place. People are standing outside. Imam Sahib al-Asr was the man. Amazing dua. Talking to Allah, describing yourself. فَلَمْ أَرَ مَوْلًا كَرِيمًا أَصْبَرَ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِ اللَّئِيمِ مِنْكَ عَلَيَّ يَا رَبْ. You confessing, you talking to Allah is form of munajat. Don't miss dua iftitah. It comes once a year. Try as much as you can in these last days and night of Ramadan. Participate and attend dua iftitah. It's more important than whatever you think you are doing, wallah. The other platform of Ramadan is Quran. Maybe there are those they've not yet opened Quran since the beginning of Ramadan. If you've not opened, I have an excuse. Jamaat, they've got Quran khani. At least. لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ رَبِيعٍ وَرَبِيعُ الْقُرْآنِ شَحْرُ رَمَضَانِ. Everything has a spring. And the spring of Quran is Ramadan. Let Quran illuminate from your heart in the month of Ramadan. Have you started? You've not started? Since Ramadan, have you opened Quran in your house? You've not opened? You have to begin. It is the food your soul wants. If there is nothing that the soul wants. These are the things the soul wants in Ramadan. Look at Allah in Quran. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَقَّلُونَ. That is the power of Quran. That when Quran is being recited on those sincere slaves and servants of Allah, their heart will find tremor. The heart will shake. It will pierce. Don't feel shy. Sometimes you recite these verses of Quran. Allah says, لو أنزلنا هذا القرآن على جبل لرأيته خاشعا متصدعا من خشية الله. If this Quran were to revealed on mountains, mountains will break into pieces as a result of the fear of Allah. Where are believers? Allah said, Quran. So therefore, if you take and hold unto Quran, it will pierce your heart, I promise you. It will appeal to your heart. If it appeals to stones and mountains, why will it not appeal to hearts? So therefore, another platform is Quran. It's either you recite yourself, or at least leave iftar very quickly and come and join the mu'mineen who are reciting in the mosque. At least you do not allow a day or night to pass in Ramadan without ensuring that one verse of Quran runs on your tongue and moves in your heart and your ears. Now, last but not least of the platform of Ramadan is the 3 nights of Qadr. There is no time in a year where your soul requires and demands you than those 3 nights of Qadr. Big Adama, the greatness is a profound night. When Allah said, Khayrun min alfi shahar. That night is night of ibadah. When a'amal finish, You should find an excuse to remain and keep night vigil to give your soul what it wants. There are people after Amal of Qadr, they go and sleep. When Allah said, Salamun hiya hatta matla'il fajr. Until fajr. So I'm just giving you glossaries. Qadr is another moment to feed your soul. Give it a lot of food. And it coincides with the departure of Mawlai Kainat, isn't it? Scholars advise me and you, let's live modestly, let's live simply, eat simple in those nights, dress simple in those nights, remember Amir al-Mu'mineen in that sajda, and do ibadah. Stay away from laughing and jiggling. Those are the nights you have to be serious and engrossed in the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Three nights are very important tonight. Feel the fast of that night. Even your iftar, review it in those nights. Eat, but don't eat. You know what all distract our soul is varieties of meals we take. This is what distracts the soul. So those three nights is a platform for you. And in conclusion, we try, brothers, as much as we can in this holy month of Ramadan. If you cannot do anything at all, make tawbah. And the best tawbah is dua al-tawbah of Imam Zainul Abidin. At least once in Ramadan, recite that dua with its meaning and understanding. Therefore, Imam, in his Munajat al-Shaqeen, Imam Zainul Abidin, he's got Munajat al-Shaqeen, the Munajat of those who doubt. Imam taught us, waswas too much with you. There are people, they will make wudu 10 times and they are still doubting whether the wudu is correct or not. We have people like that. They are too much conscious that now, even after Salat, they doubting if the Salat is accepted or is not accepted by Allah. There are people, they doubt even this a'mal we've done, is it accepted or is not accepted? Munajat al-Shaqeen of Imam Zain al-Abideen in Mafat al-Jinan. Very small munajat. Take it, Ilahi. Ashku ilayka nafsan ammarat bisu. Ya Allah, I complain to you, this nafsul ammara wa ila al-khati'ati mubadara. This is my nafs. It is swift and hurry in jumping into doing wrongs. Wa bima'asika mula'a. This nafs, it goes to sinning against you. وَلِسَخْتِكَ مُتَعَرَّدَ. Ya Allah, I complain this nafs that always angers you. Imam Zain al-Abideen. Munajat al-Shaqeen, Ya Allah. We have treasures from Ahlul Bayt, brothers. That is enough for us to grow spiritually in this holy month of Ramadan. Then Imam said, يَسْلُكُ بِهَا مَسَالِكَ الْمَحَالِكَ. This nafs is moving me towards the wrong direction, towards direction of declining. وَيَجْعَلِنِي أَهْوَنْ هَالِكٍ. And it makes me miserable. كَثِيرَةُ الْعِلَلُ وَطُولُ الْأَمَلُ. Imam said, Ya Allah, full of wrongs in this nafs and a lot of ambitions coming from this nafs. And Imam at the end said, مَيَّالَةٌ لِلَّعِبِ وَاللَّحْوِ. This nafs is just dragging me towards play, towards entertainment, towards enjoyment. It's making me to forsake Allah. Allah mentioned in Quran, نَصُوا اللَّهَ فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. They forsook Allah, then Allah made them to forsake themselves. Munajat al-Shaqeen. Imam Zain al-Abidin used to this and used to cry this munajat. Therefore, brothers and sisters, I plead with you, I beg you. Our aim is to build this community, to make this community to the highest level of community who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah has given us this Ramadan. gift from Allah. When Malaika Ainat mentioned in the riwayah, when Allah said on the first night of Ramadan, Allah looks at his servant with a different look, and that look continues until the last night of Ramadan. So therefore, let's benefit. Dua ut tawbah. Ask for forgiveness of Allah. Dua umakarim al-akhlaq. Ask for forgiveness of Allah. Try as much as you can to benefit from these treasures of Ahlul Bayt. Once you do your part, you leave the rest with Allah. And Allah will take care of you, inshallah. Alladhina jahadu fina lanahdiyannahum subalana wa inna Allah lama al-muhsinin. Those who strive on our way, we will guide them to our way. The way is the way of Allah. You have to strive in the way of Allah. Then He will hold your hand and show you the way. Therefore, لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى. I am nothing, you are nothing except your effort and determination. Use your time wisely, brothers. That is my emphasis. Use it wisely. Give the soul what it deserves. And if you do that, I promise you, after Ramadan, you keep your wajibat, correct your wajibat, Allah will help you. And you will enjoy the fruit of this worship in this world. And you will be happy in this world. And you will be happy on the day of Qiyamah. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله. Tonight, inshallah, I want us to remember in this moment as we are preparing to welcome the night of Qadr, to remember the 6-month-old baby of Abba Abdullah. Because we are told, even if your heart is like rock, there is one musiba which is capable of breaking the heart. That is the musiba of Ali Asghar. This is musiba. If you have never shed tears and you pay attention to it, it will open and pierce your heart. By the time you realize, tears will start overflowing from your heart. Scholars came forward and said there are similarities between Ismail and Abba Abdullah al-Husayn. What are the similarities? They said the first similarity is that when Ibrahim was alone with Ismail, when Ibrahim was about to implement the command of Allah, Ismail requested 3 things from Ibrahim. Narration says the first thing that Ismail requested from the father, he said, Oh Papa, before you go on to do the command of Allah, I want you to close my eye. Why do you have to close my eye? Because if you look at my face, you will sympathize with me, and that will deter you from executing what you are commanded to do by Allah. Number 2, he said, Oh Papa, before you slaughter me, tie my hands and my feet. Because if you slaughter me and you see me moving from one point to another, you will not be able to fulfill the command of Allah. Number 3, Ismail said to Ibrahim, Oh my beloved father, after you have slaughtered me, I want you to take my cloth back to my mother, because it kills my mother to know that I'm slaughtered and I'm gone. Now the question that our great scholars of Mimbar normally ask is that, Ya Abba Abdullah al-Husayn, on the 10th day of Muharram, when you took Ali Asghar from Sayyida Zainab, Because we are told on that day, Rubaba had no energy to give Ali Asgar to Aba Abdullah. Who gave Ali Asgar to Aba Abdullah? It was Sayyida Zainab. Why Rubaba had no energy? Riwaya said because the sand was not moving. And Rubaba saw the lips of the sand was dry. And the sand was not moving. My mothers know, if the children and the infant are not moving, how do you feel, our mothers? Now Sayyida Zainab brought Ali Asgar to Aba Abdullah. When she brought Ali Asgar, the question ulama ask is that, oh Aba Abdullah, on the 10th day of Muharram, did you know that the child will flap his wings and hunt? Some scholars related to the way bird flap their wings, huh? Said, Aba Abdullah, do you know that you do that? Because Ismail, he said to Ibrahim, oh my beloved father, tie my hands and my feet, because I don't want to see you moving. Aba Abdullah ibn Hussein, how do you feel when Ali Akbar was moving on your hand? Now the second question scholars ask when they look at this situation of Ismail and Ibrahim. Said Aba Abdullah, how difficult was it to go back to Bibi Rubaba? Isn't it, Aba Abdullah, after Ali Asgar was slain in his hand, he went back and forth 7 times, Inna Lillah wa Inna Ilayhi Rajun. Inna Lillah, back and forth, battlefield, the tent, the khaymaga, going and coming, back and forth, Inna Lillah. So they said, Aba Abdullah, how was it easy for you or difficult for you to go to Bibi Rubaba? Now scholars said, when Ismail was placed on the land of Hijaz, Ismail started moving his hand from one point to another. Then the water of Zamzam gushed out. Here they ask a question, Ya Aba Abdullah, on the 10th day of Muharram, when you place Ali Asgar on the land of Karbala, there was no any water gushing from the earth for Ali Akbar, Ali Asgar. But when Ismail was placed on the ground, water came out from the earth. Therefore, Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, when he was holding Ali Asgar, Riwayah said he brought Asgar to the battlefield. He placed Asgar in the middle of the battlefield. Aba Abdullah came back and he raised up his head. He looked at the camp of Umar ibn Sa'd. Said, is there anyone who will give water to my beloved son? They said, Wallah, we want to see Hussein being broken into pieces. There will be no water for your son. In conclusion, Riwaya said, the best person who described this event was Harmala. When Mukhtar got hold of Harmala in revenging what transpired in Karbala. Isn't it, Riwaya said, from Luhufa, oh Harmala, what did you do on the 10th day of Muharram? Harmala said, I had 7 targets. 3 of them went unsuccessful, and 4 of those targets I was successful. Mukhtar asked him, what were those 4 targets that you were successful? He said, the first one was, of course, to the nephew of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. When Aba Abdullah was on the ground, Abdullah rushed to come and defend Aba Abdullah. Harmala said, as this young boy was getting closer to the body of Aba Abdullah, I struck my arrow to the body of this young son. He asked him, the second arrow was to who? He said, the second arrow, when I realized that Abul Fadl al-Abbas, all the 2 hands were chopped off, I stood and targeted and I struck my second arrow. That second arrow went to the right eye of Abul Fadl al-Abbas. Then he asked him, then your third arrow, he said, this hurt me so much. The third arrow, he said, as Hussein was holding the infant baby and Hussein was pleading for water, I struck my arrow to the neck of the infant baby. And of course, the last arrow was on the body of Aba Abdullah al-Hussein. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un.
وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون والعاقبة للمتقين. اللهم إنا نرغب إليك في دولة كريمة تعز بها الإسلام وأهله وتذل بها النفاق وأهله وتجعلنا فيها من الدعاة إلى طاعتك والقادة إلى سبيلك وترزقنا بها كرامة الدنيا والآخرة. وصل اللهم على محمد وآله الطاهرين.